Good morning, guys. I'm back. This is Papa D on Papa D's Range Time, and obviously we are not on my range again today. I'm here again with Dirty D here and Rolf Pareles with Shooters Paradise Incorporated in Ethel, Louisiana. Last week we discussed a little bit about the why and shooting and training and stuff like that. This week we want to touch on something a little bit different. I've trained. I've got skills. I can hit my targets. How do I know if I'm prepared? Am I prepared? What do I need from here? How do I get to the point that I know I can take and do this?
So the big question, am I ready for that life and death attack? The answer is probably no.
No.
Yeah.
That's not what I want to hear.
No, it's not what I want to hear either, because it applies to me also. But that's probably where I am, and I need to look at this and kind of evaluate my training, where I am, and what do I need to do to get as prepared as possible.
Okay, are there classes or people that do this?
Well, to do this particular thing, I don't think there are. I think this is an introspection and ask yourself questions to see, are you ready? I think that's the thing. So having somebody provide a guide for this would be super valuable, and I don't know anyone in the country who's doing that.
So I have to put myself into, say, real-life situations like, okay, I'm sitting in a car,
yes,
and somebody walks up to the window.
Yes. What do I do? If I don't have an answer for that, I'm not ready. I need to have an answer in my mind for whatever situation I can envision.
And role-play that over
yes,
and over.
Yes, in your mind. And you know, you could do this with your spouse, a best friend, close friend, that kind of thing would be very valuable just to discuss it. Because just the discussing of it will provide incredible ability when the event actually occurs.
So what other situations, and I know there's hundreds of them, I mean, I just mentioned sitting in a car.
Yes, yes.
I guess sitting in my living room and somebody tries to kick in my door.
Right, right. So do I have a self-defense plan at home? If I don't have a plan in place, well, that means I'm not prepared. Because in a life and death encounter, there is no time to think. If I am thinking about what should I do in a life and death encounter,
it's too late.
I am done. That's right. Because the thing that we don't ever stop to consider is that the bad guy who's coming after us has a plan. He's thought through what he's going to do. And that plan includes preventing me from figuring out something to do in return.
He's on offense, then I'm on defense, and
yes,
I have to take a shift of gears somehow.
Yes, that momentary shift is where you see the freeze, and everybody has a momentary shift, and that will take a split second, or it could take 10 seconds or 10 minutes. I mean, that's the freeze. And at that point then, if I don't have something already ingrained up here to do in response to this, I'm in trouble.
So how do I get the plan of action? I mean, is that through courses?
Well, the courses will provide us the general outline of the safe area to act. It's just like this. I can say that we hear a lot about gear and holsters, and, well, it works for me. That's the argument. It works for me. Well, I used to think that about the Serpa holster. And the problem with the Serpa holster is if you draw and you're under adrenaline, or under excitement when you draw, and you don't hit the button right.
Can't get it out.
Well, you can't get it out, and then your brain says, push the button, and you push the button wrong, and then your finger can go on the trigger. And I actually had that happen to me in a self-defense class. I was using a Serpa holster, and I had used it for years before. Man, this is a great holster. Works good. Works, yeah, works for me. And so then, in the middle of the class, I'm drawing under time pressure, and fight, fight, and they're, you know, yelling at me and everything. And I go to pull that gun out, and I felt my finger hit the trigger as the gun came out of the holster. I was like, oh, I'm good. So understanding that the Serpa doesn't work for me. If there's any possibility I'm going to have to draw the gun under excitement, the Serpa doesn't work for me. Knowing that, that's the stuff. I don't know what I don't know. Okay. And so I need to come up with plans, but those plans need to be run through the filter of this is what we know about how we act under adrenaline, what we can and can't do, what's legal, what's not legal, what's ethical and moral, because I have to live with myself after a self-defense incident.
I hope I'm ready, but I hope I never have to draw a gun, much less shoot somebody.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely.
But my life is more important than theirs.
Yes. Yes. I'm number one.
And I know on holsters, I carry at a 4 o'clock position outside the waistband so that I can access my firearm from both hands. Mm-hmm. And being right hand disabled right now, my outside the waistband holster, I have practiced still in the same spot, coming around with my left hand and being able to get rounds on target. Mm-hmm. I've also done that from the ground, from kneeling, from behind cover, so that I know that I'm putting myself in different situations.
Absolutely.
Trying to figure out if I'm ready.
What I've been working on recently is, have I really prepared my students to defend themselves in that fight for their lives?
Right.
Because that's all that matters, is
yes.
the students and whether they're you know, ready for this. Otherwise, it's all just theater, you know, and that's not what I don't want that. I want people to really be ready to defend themselves. So, looking at it, the first thing we have is the level of skills. Can I hit what I'm aiming at?
Right.
The next step up is tactics, which is how I apply those skills.
Okay.
So, if I'm seated in a car, how do I hit what I'm aiming at? Because that's different than standing there at the indoor range in the booth like you talk about.
Yes.
Yeah, so that's tactics now. It's
okay.
applying my skills. Skills is hitting what I'm aiming at. How do I do that? How do I apply that in the real world? That's tactics.
Sometimes that'd be probably just as easy on an outdoor range to sit in a chair.
Yes,
simulating.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
All right.
And then you can set up a barrel in front of you or some other obstacle and shoot around that. And, you know, the
steering wheel.
Car window, the steering wheel. Yeah, we can mimic this stuff. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so that becomes tactics.
Okay.
Do I run or do I shoot? Do I drive? Do I shoot? That's tactics. Okay? It's just the application of my skills. But that doesn't address the overall strategy level, which is, how am I going to win? I have to have a plan. Oh, my plan is to escape and evade. Okay, well, how are you going to do that?
What does that involve?
Exactly. So, but if I just think, well, I'm going to out-wrestle the bad guy, if that's my plan, and his plan involves not going to the ground in the first place, he's already thought about, what if this guy wants to wrestle? I'm not going to do that. I'll do this to stop him. My planned out wrestling is not going to work.
He knows his strengths, and he's going to take and play to his strengths.
He's already, my great plan, I'm going to out, like if I was a black belt in Taekwondo, and I plan to out kick the bad guy.
Keeping distance.
Or I'm a boxer, and I plan to out punch the bad guy. And his plan involves not ever allowing me to throw a punch in the first place. I've already lost.
Yes.
So I have to have some overall plan about how I'm going to win. And if I don't have that strategy, then the skill itself is not... I mean, you've heard me, we've talked about how there's a lot of people that carry guns on a daily basis that are never going to get that gun out in the fight for their life.
Not being able to take a scan, be aware,
yeah.
understand the interview process that a criminal goes through.
Absolutely.
So what steps do criminals go through to take and find you as a victim?
Okay, so that's really deep subject. Mark McGeown has 5 items on the steps of an attack.
Okay.
And you can break it down. The first thing is the criminal's intent. He has to want to mug somebody. He's got to have that planned already. Get up in the morning, I feel like I'm going to rob somebody today. You and I don't think like that.
So, he has to get his next fix. The only way he's going to do it is get something from you.
Sure. So you have that first. You have the intent. And then he's going to pick me. The moment he sees me, subconsciously, he's going to say, that one. And he's going to pick me. All right? And at that point, then, he doesn't want to get hurt. Right?
I can agree with that, yeah.
So the criminal doesn't want to get hurt. So he's picked me, and he had a split-second decision process to pick me. And it's all subconscious. So now he wants to make sure I'm not going to hurt him back. Because he doesn't care about hurting me, but he doesn't want to get hurt.
Okay.
So that's where we have the interview. And the interview is a process of him to verify that, yeah, I'm a good, in prison terms, a pork chop. I'm ripe for the picking. You know, I am a good victim.
Okay.
So in his, oftentimes the interview process starts out with, hey, buddy, you got a light? That's how it starts. And your reactions to how close he stands to you, how you treat him and all those, it's all subconscious psychological evaluation of how we react to his questioning.
And all he's trying to do is get closer to you.
Well, it's not just that. He's also trying to verify we're safe for him to attack. Because you are going to give off a different vibe when he starts that business, and he's going to go, this guy's trouble. Right?
He wants the easy target.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay.
So he wants the greatest return for least effort, right?
Yep.
So that interview is that next process. Hey, buddy, can you spare a dollar? And he like with the light, he doesn't have a cigarette. Hey, buddy, you got a light? And he's got no cigarette. What do you need a light for? Come on, right?
Right.
So during the interview process where he's pinging us and checking to see if we're dangerous to him or not, he will position us. And that is, if I step into your personal space, you're going to take a step back to recreate your personal space. And so they'll move us around the corner of the convenience store building where they can rob us, where they can hit us in the head with a brick so that there's no witnesses. So he will set up like a sucker punch. He's going to set up his sucker punch by getting into the right position for the sucker punch during the interview process. So those two go hand in hand.
Okay.
And it's critical that we fail the interview. It's critical that he gets the point that we are not who he wants. We're not a good victim.
Okay.
That we will fight and it's not going to go well for him. The final part of those five steps is the reaction. And it's not my reaction to his attack, it's his reaction to his attack. So when a guy has got a gun and he's pointing it at me, oftentimes these criminals feel a great sense of justice. He's making everything right in the world. He's been oppressed his whole life, and now he's holding the people accountable who oppressed him. And he feels good about what he's doing. He feels like it's just, this is justice happening, other things like that. And sometimes these criminals can get to the point where they're feeling like they enjoy this power they have over you. And then you can have a robbery go off the tracks and become a murder. And so the reaction of the criminal to what he's doing and the power he has over you at that point becomes a huge thing. And that's the five stages of an attack.
Unfortunately, I don't think that way.
Yes, we don't. And that's where we're behind the eight ball, because we're constantly thinking, well, if I simply do this and act normally, then he's going to act normally. Because normal people do that. But in this case, that's not actually the case. It was all set up from the beginning.
Almost sounds like he's getting an adrenaline rush off of the superiority over you and
yes.
Going to feed
yes.
off of that.
Yes.
So and what happens next, who knows?
That's a specific subset of criminal, because a lot of really experienced muggers, it's all just business. They don't get emotionally tied up into what they're doing at all. It's all just cold, hard business. And if you give them what they want, you're gone. And that's why the police say to give criminals what they want. They want your wallet, give them your wallet. The reason why is because that's the largest group of criminals, and
okay.
It works most of the time.
Okay.
Unfortunately, the police don't mention, well, if that doesn't work, then here's the whole other thing you need to consider.
Things can go real bad.
Yeah, but that is something I look at. I'm prepared to be a good victim, and I carry a little extra chump change, a little extra cash to give a criminal in that situation, because maybe that'll suffice. If I give him $20 and I don't have to kill him, oh, that's great. Anyway.
Or be killed.
Yes. Oh, yeah. That's always on the table. The good guy doesn't always win.
So I know you have some training classes coming up here in September.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me a little bit about them and what's going to be going on with that?
Okay, so we have Rory Miller and Randy King coming. Rory Miller is a very famous martial artist. He's written a number of books, and he is highly skilled in understanding the criminal motivations and how they work, because he worked in the correction field for many, many years. He dealt every day with criminals, and he learned a lot of hard lessons from that. That's September 24, 25, and 26.
3 days, okay.
Yep. The first day is a three-hour session on risk assessments and understanding my personal risk levels. Then the next 2 days are Rory's class, Ambushes and Thugs. And there will be some lecture in it talking about criminals, who they are, how they function, and then there'll be a lot of actual doing and hands-on scenario stuff where people come up and, hey, buddy, what are you looking at? And we have to respond to that. So it'll be a very fun class where we actually get to do, it's not just sitting there writing and taking notes and taking tests. There'll be a lot of fun with this one.
How many people are you expecting to have in the class?
We can have up to 40.
Okay.
So it can be a very good sized class. So we'll see how many people have got the interest in it. The class is going to cost $500, and it includes a risk assessment class on Friday, and then Saturday and Sunday, the Ambushes and Thugs class.
Will they be able to find that information on your website?
Yes.
Shooters,
yes.
Paradise Incorporated.
Yep.
.com?
Yes.
Okay. We're not the best technical people out here. We're fighting it and it's winning.
So yes.
We're doing what we can.
That's correct.
What other classes away from the ordinary concealed carry NRA classes do you have coming up?
I'm always left wanting in this question. We have a schedule on our website, and okay. I'd recommend people go there. We offer tons of different classes from pepper spray all the way up to our Mag 20 class, which is 20 hours of high-level shooting, developing skills. That's 500 rounds in 2 days, and it's a high level of skill development.
Okay.
We offer many different classes. I'd recommend people go check out our schedule online.
Okay, and if they have any questions, they can always call
yes,
you.
They,
your phone number is?
225-244-4002. That's okay. 225-244-4002.
Super. And again, I highly recommend Rolf and Marlon, his wife, as far as the way that they put on a class and understanding the why, giving us the information that we need so that we can take and stay safe, so we can evaluate ourselves and be able to be the best that we can be. I know you had mentioned John Murphy coming up in March.
2022.
Yes.
Yes.
What does John Murphy offer?
So John Murphy is offering a concealed carry class. It's a two-day course, but it's not your average concealed carry class. This is all the skills that you need to conceal carry that you didn't get in your course. This is how to deal with that guy that comes up to you on the street, how you talk to him from the very first moment you see him until the end of the situation. It'll involve the use of pepper spray. We'll have inert pepper spray canisters that we'll be spraying people with. It's all the critical stuff that you didn't get. And it'll be role-playing and acting. You know, this will be a fun on-the-range type class. It's not
awesome.
Sitting there listening to a PowerPoint.
That sounds great. Yep. Well, guys, if you want to find out more, again, Shooters Paradise Incorporated is the website. Rolf offers classes almost every weekend, a variety of topics and subjects. He's always open for a phone call and to be able to explain more and to take and help out. Wealth of knowledge. I really appreciate you taking the time to be with me today to get this YouTube video out. And guys, this is Papa D signing off for another video, and we're going to see you down the road on the next video. Thank you so much for watching.